Thank you, Cheryl, for playing, getting this going here. A little bit of rain this afternoon. Somebody said to me, Louise loved the rain. So I think she sent it, and we get to enjoy that. It was a great treat this afternoon. Waiting just a little bit to start because us Southern Californians don't know how to drive in the rain, so we make sure everybody's here. Those of you Northern Californians, you know a little more than that. My name is Greg. I'm one of the pastors here at Emmanuel Faith, and on behalf of this family, of Steve and Vicki and Jennifer and their families, thank you for coming. This is a celebration. Celebration of a life well lived. There's so many dimensions to Louise. I'm confident that regardless of how well you know her, you are going to learn something today that you didn't know. And we'll get a chance to talk about her and to share those stories in ways that I hope will be an encouragement to you. I hope we all learn something, and at the same time we can encourage those who've been closest to her and loved her as her family has all these years. Would you join me in praying? Just asking God to be honored in what we do. Let's pray together. Father, we quiet our hearts before we go into this time of remembrance to recognize that you are Louise's creator, her Lord, her love. So much of who she was is a reflection of what you wanted for her. Character, her passion, her priorities. Oh God, thank you. Thank you for her. I would invite you as a sovereign creator, God, to get your way this afternoon. And what we say and how we remember her, I'd also invite your spirit, God, to do its work in our hearts and minds to help us in our journey. Not only in the loss, but what we do with what we know about her and what we've learned from her. God, that our lives might be richer and more meaningful in perspective for what you have for us. So thank you. We ask that all things be honoring to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I hope you got one of these memorial folders on the way in. This is our guide for this afternoon. Before we move into some special music, Cheyenne, who is Louise's granddaughter, is going to come and read for us from Psalm 23. So Cheyenne, I'm going to turn it over to you here.
I'm going to read Psalm 23, Psalm of David. It's my favorite psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in your presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
I know your love. Hi, I'm Kathy Davis, and I'm honored to be able to say a few words about such an amazing woman. I met Louise and John about 16 years ago when we moved two doors down from them in a house that John built. I have many fond memories of Louise, and they weren't really the big moments in life. They were the little moments that make up a life. I remember the wonderful dinners we used to spend with the O'Donnells, who lived in the house between the two of us. We'd go over there and we'd eat and we'd drink probably a little too much wine and play some fun and silly games, and that was always fun. And then one time the O'Donnells had invited Louise and I over for an English tea. And we all got dressed up and wore hats, and their oldest daughter Claire made the tea, and we had cucumber sandwiches, and it was just a lot of fun. Every year also I get tickets for the Emmanuel Faith Christmas concert. And we all come to the concert for the O'Donnells, and Louise and myself and my husband Steve. We come here and we have the concert, listen to the concert, and then we'd go home to my house and we'd have dinner. I remember our weekly walks, Louise and I, with our dog, with little Louie and my lab Kenzie. We go to Kit Carson Park every Friday and take them for a walk. And at least once or twice a week, Louise would call me and say, "Come on over for some tea." So I would come over and we'd spend an hour or two chatting, or she'd sometimes come over to my house and bring Louie so that the dogs can play out in the backyard. It's just a lot of good memories like that with her. PEO, as a lot of you know, PEO was a big part of her life, and I'll always be grateful for her for inviting me to join PEO. She was my role model, and she had so many wonderful traits, but I'll just take some time to mention a few of them. First of all was her love of the Lord. She had such a close walk with God, and she never stopped learning about him, was always ready to share her love of God with others so that they too might get to know him. The second thing I always admired about her was her elegance. She was probably the most elegant woman I've ever known. She always looked terrific, even in the hospital. I remember she was in a full body brace, neck brace. She hadn't had a chance to wash her hair or put on makeup, but she didn't look any different. She looked like the fabulous Louise I always remembered. Another thing was this, and I'm serious about this, was her marksmanship. She was a legend on Sorrentino Drive for her marksmanship and her shooting ability. There were some coyotes that were living in the oleanders between her house and the O'Donnell's house, and she drove them out. And during that time, of course, the rest of us tried to wear bright colors so there'd be no confusion between us. And one of the last things I want to share about the traits I loved was her self-assuredness. She was probably the most self-assured person I have ever met. She could do whatever she put her mind to, whether it was pottery or sculpture or art or interior design or cooking or mahjong, just to name a few. And I used to tell her that she would have made a great pioneer woman. I mean, can't you see her going across the plains in a covered wagon? I mean, I can totally see her doing that. Or even better yet, I can see her scouting for Lewis and Clark. And of course, she would look fabulous in buckskins and a coonskin cap with the rifle slung over her arm. And you know, it wouldn't be long before she'd be leading the expedition. I mean, she was that kind of gal. I used to tell Louise when I grew up, I wanted to be just like her. Which brings me to the mystery of Louise's age. It's the one thing she wouldn't share with her friends. And when I asked her why she wouldn't tell us her age, she said that when people know your age, they treat you a certain way, which in Louise's case would have been a big mistake. So in closing, I'd like to read something that was given to me many years ago. It's called Gone From My Sight. It was written by Henry Van Dyke. I am standing upon the seashore. A ship at my side spreads her white sails to the morning breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud just where the sea and the sky come to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, "There, she's gone." "Gone where?" "Gone from my sight, that's all. She is just as large in mast and hull and spar as she was when she left my side, and she is just as able to bear her load of living freight to her destined port. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at the moment when someone at my side says, "There she is gone," they're otherwise watching her coming, another voice is ready to take up the glad shout, "Here she comes." And that is dying.
I'm Elizabeth Pyle, and I'm a longtime friend of Louise. When we lose a friend, it feels like a hole in our heart. I think that all of you will agree with me that we have been fortunate to have known Louise and that we all are better for it. I have known Louise for many years. Randy and I were newcomers to the church, and pretty soon we realized we better get into a smaller group if we want to get to know someone. So we did. We were sitting in Sunday school group, by Coda we call it. I was looking across the room, and there I saw John and Louise and thought, I want to get to know that couple. I want to be their friend. The rest is history. We realized that we had a lot in common. We have worked together. We had fun together. We laughed and cried together. Louise had passion for many things. She loved life and didn't want to miss out on anything. She wanted to have fun, and she talked about the exciting life that John and she had together. Sometimes I thought it sounded really daring, if you ask me. It was thrilling to Louise, though. She knew that life could be an adventure, and she didn't want to end it. She wanted to live the life to the fullest. She was very artistic, as you all know, and she saw beauty all around her, and we saw the beauty in her. Louise was very concerned about what's happening in the world. She was rooted in her faith and hope, and her heart always reached out to the young. She always said and asked, "Pray for our children and grandchildren." I believe she is doing that today. This is the kind of friend she was. We have lost a friend like that in Louise. We will miss her, but it's only temporary. We haven't lost her. We know where she is, and we will meet again when it's our turn. Thank you, Louise, for enriching my life just by knowing you.
It isn't everybody that gets an escort. My name is Sharon Culbertson. And I think it's what Elizabeth and Kathy said, I could just say ditto. But I do have just a few more things to say. Anyway, Louise and I first became friends when Byron and I moved to Escondido in 1989, and I asked someone who was a good interior designer, and guess who they said? Louise. Well, Louise came into our life that way, and it's never been the same. It's just been wonderful. She has been a close friend ever since we moved here, and I met her in July of 1989. And because we became friends, our husbands became friends. So we did a lot of things together. Lots of fun things, lots of silly things, and lots of serious things. Because both John and Louise had a wonderful sense of humor. Louise and I were in Bible study, Sunday school, PEO, Mahjong together. We lunched and shopped together. Oh, did we shop? We had fun. And she was blaming me for buying some of her clothes. I don't know why. I always told her they looked good on her because she was such a beautiful, elegant, sophisticated lady. So everything looked good on her. She could be serious and passionate about her opinions, but she could also laugh at herself and be lighthearted and adventuresome. If Louise was passionate about any issue, there was never any doubt as to where she stood on that issue. So, and I loved her for that too. Her love of the Lord and her family remained a priority in her life. God gave me a treasured gift with my friendship with Louise that deepened with each passing year. She was a precious sister in the Lord, and I will miss her greatly. But I rejoice that she is no longer in pain, but is whole and healed again, and is with the Lord and in the presence of John.
I don't like it up here. It's scary. How do you explain my mom? She was a multifaceted woman with a steadfast love of the Lord and belief in His Word. She studied and shared, this might help, these beliefs her entire life, and I was so in awe of her strength. It was a basis from which all about her grew. There are so many aspects of her personality that I could expound on, and I'm only going to pick a few, and Kathy mentioned several. Her love of family. She could be a tiger if anybody threatened or talked badly about her family, and she never gave up on any of us. No matter what the situation, we always knew Mom would be there to love, support, and cheer us on. And by the way, that included Louie, her little dog. When she thought he was in danger of being eaten by a coyote, she took her .22 and shot it right through the porch screen. She was afraid if she opened the door, it would run away. Mom felt that God put animals here to make us laugh and enjoy as companions, and Louie sure filled the bill. Next was her class, her grace and elegance. I mean, I've never known anybody as classy and elegant always. I mean, always. We very seldom saw her, even in sweats. I mean, she was always so elegant. She had a fun-loving spirit. Her diligence about nutrition and exercise. Of course, the times after the gym were her favorite, when she and the ladies would meet at Starbucks for coffee to talk and giggle like little girls. I love that about her. Her desire to learn new things. She was always learning. Lately it was Mahjong, and she took it to heart. She had the tiles and the directions out on her dining room table, which normally she would never have anything sitting out on her table, and she would study diligently. She was so excited when she would win a game. Her artistic talent and knowledge about art and design, which you all know, her willingness to help anyone in need,
Her mentoring, she schooled so many women about God's word and even about ordinary things like how to set a table and arrange flowers and stuff like that. I can go on and on, but my most favorite aspect about my mother was her enthusiasm for everything. She took on life with wide open arms, and her smile and joyfulness was always there. Even little things, you could always just see. It's like, okay, what are we going to do today? Her expectation was everything was going to be good. She radiated joy and love. She was an exceptional and rare person, and I feel so blessed to be her daughter and been able to experience her spirit all these years. I do and will miss her so much. My only consolation is that she's out of pain and with her Lord and my dad, whom she missed daily. Now she can finally teach him to sing, "You Are My Sunshine." She tried to do it 60 years ago, and it didn't work. Also to dance. She was fabulous at both, and Dad, not so much. So I envision him laughing, dancing, and singing away, and the heavy pain lifts my heart a little. Your turn. Your Jenna's turn.
Sadly, my sister and I got my dad's voice.
Singing voice.
Singing voice. We had the occasion to sing, try to sing Amazing Grace to Mom, and Bonnie was there at the time. This was just a few days before she passed. And in other circumstances, we would have cleared the room, but Bonnie was a trooper and she stayed through all of that. And I think you might be tone deaf, but we value and appreciated all of that. Mom's smile just lit up a room. It's hard to find anyone that I know that had her grace, beauty, passion for life, and just intellectual curiosity. She was always finding a way to serve and support. She was the reason that, I mean, both we've all done community service of both time and money is the example that our parents set for us. She was just a jewel, and it's so hard to think that she's not here with us now. Of course, you know, while we've been so blessed to have her in our lives for so many years, you know, my brother and sister had her for far longer than me.
Such a brat.
Yeah. The younger sister, you know. But so many of our family memories are centered around food, and I know many of you have experienced Mom's cooking. And she had an approach. She was very a fabulous cook. But she would plan a dinner party, and she would get the recipes out, and she'd try them, and then she'd tweak them, and then she'd try them again until she got them exactly the way that she wanted. And we have memories from very simple meals of going, when I was very young, and you guys were water skiing, you know, we would go skiing on the Delta and come home all sandy and zinc noses, and she'd have a homemade pot of clam chowder and oysters, and we would just think we were the most special kids in the world. From that to picnics to elegant dinner parties, it was all her way of giving and caring for those that she loved. And better watch out if you came to the table not being able to share pieces of your life and not being able to exchange information over the dinner table and be current on world events. Because if that was, even when I was a kid, that was one of the standards that we had, you know. You couldn't be ill-informed if you wanted to sit at the table and enjoy this wonderful food. I have so many memories of doing homework in art spaces and galleries when Mom was volunteering as a docent in theaters, and she was always finding a way, and I know Vicki's touched on that, and Steve, I'm not sure what you're going to be able to talk about.
Yeah, I'm beginning to feel that.
But there are so many things that we've learned from her over the years. I came across a few days ago a gratitude book. And, you know, I don't know about you guys, but for me, exercising is one of those obligations you do because you have to and kind of get through it. For Mom, it's something that she wrote about in her gratitude book, you know, that she was thankful that she had the the ability to do that and to have a great place to exercise and these wonderful friends to do it with, and then to go have coffee afterwards at Starbucks, which we talked about. It was a joy, and she shared a lot of her life and some very funny times. But Mom was also a bit of a prankster, and one year, it's very hard to pull a prank on Mom. It really is. This may be one of the things that you take away that you didn't know about Mom. But one year we were together at Thanksgiving, and this is what she's written in her gratitude book for that day. And Turkey Day, I defrosted the apple pie I made and froze. I made cornbread stuffing for the first time with bread from Trader's. Jenna made chestnut mushroom stuffing, and Vicky brought some pumpkin chocolate pecan and chocolate pies. I can't believe the trick my kids played on me. They put a little Cornish game hen in the turkey. I knew nothing of this. So when it came time to carve the turkey, Steve, after a few slices, pulled this little dead-looking white thing out of the cavity of the turkey, and I was dumbfounded. I wasn't about to eat that turkey. And the kids just loved the joke, and they videotaped it. So I don't know how this is all going to turn out, but in spite of it all, dinner was wonderful, and it was fabulous to have my kids here and one, at least one of my grandchildren, Cheyenne, Friday, November 26th. The book is filled with daily remembrances and things to be grateful for in our lives, and it's an inspiration to me to remember that. I'd like to share something that I also we came across and that she had on her desk, and it's from Esther 4:13. I'm just going to read an excerpt of it. And I'm reminded of all how valuable her friends were to her, as well as her family. And we're so fortunate and blessed we are that we had her for as long as we did. This is an excerpt from Esther 4:13. She said, "Dear God, this is my friend whom I love, and this is my prayer for her. Help her to live to the fullest. Please cause her to excel above her expectations. Help her to shine in the darkest places where it is impossible to love. Protect her at all times. Lift her up when she needs you the most, and let her know when she walks with you, she will always be safe. Amen." Thank you. Do you have anything left?
Not much. First of all, I'd like to read something that my wife wrote, her only daughter-in-law. "I met Mom in September 1967, newly married to her son and never been away from home. She and Dad welcomed me into their home. I did not know a whole lot about being a wife, and she taught me so many wonderful things. She taught me about cooking, nutrition, organization of a home, interior decorating, and many other things. She listened to me and gave good advice. In 1979, she and I both began to pray for our families together and stayed prayer partners all these years. Mom was a generous, a loving Christian wife, mother, friend. She was faithful, a faithful, loyal friend who always seemed to know what to say in time of need. She encouraged me through some very rough times and prayed with me and stood with me. I could have looked the world over and never been so blessed to have such a wonderful mother. She and Dad produced three beautiful and handsome children that enriched my life in this. And it's because of Mom and Dad being there and teaching them such great values. As we pass this down to our children and their children, I hope we can live up to the moral compass. We had great fun, wonderful memories in other times, and we all came together with our reunions. She made sure that we had fun and lots of things to do, and she made us all feel special. I would like to, my feelings of mom are summed up in Proverbs 31:10-31. If anybody would like to read that. Give me a second. Caught me by surprise. Being the only son, I have a few different memories of mom than the girls, and I'll make it short. Some of my earliest memories of mom were of her insisting that I sit up straight, don't bend over, hold my head up, walk like I had a purpose, and be confident. At the time, it was a little annoying. I was only six. But later in life, I come to realize that she was helping build my character, and hopefully it worked.
What a character.
Later, when I was a teenager, you know, and had issues in my life, as most of us did, mom always listened, and she always understood. And she did more listening than talking, and that helped more than anything. When I married and moved away, mom always made sure that we had family reunions. We got together. We had reunions on houseboats and other places, and she always made it fun. Family was important, and we all knew it because of mom. She was quick to smile, full of energy, articulate, and talented, probably the most talented woman I've ever known. She was absolutely the best mother a son could ask for. She's together with Dad now, and I know she's happy. Thank you.
She prayed and had us pray relentlessly for her family. She loved all of you. and just embraced Matthew's girlfriend, Brittany, and just loved her and encouraged her, and just, I mean, how she just never gave up on prayer, and that's how I remember her.
Thank you. stand as we sing Amazing Grace.
Put that together, Jennifer? I kind of had your touch on that. Did you like it? She smiled big with her friends. She smiled bigger with her grandchildren. She smiled biggest with the gun. You see that big old smile on her? No wonder she didn't miss. That girl had a passion, all right? Yeah, but when you were talking about the coyotes in the neighborhood, I was thinking, I don't know if PETA knows about this woman, but... What a delight, Louise. Thank you for sharing, those of you who did. Just a delight. And for the three of you to get up and share your mom, very meaningful. I don't know if you got a chance on the way in to look at all the little places that she's been involved, from the sculpting to the societies. I was told she was president of the Felicita Foundation, a commissioner for the California Center of the Arts in Escondido, a public art commissioner. ACIP design intern. She had all these dimensions to her life. And then those of us here at church knew her from her involvement in choir and BICOTA, this adult group that got together and cared for each other and learned together. She was a marriage mentor. Just all these dimensions of her life. And then the PEO and the organizations that she was involved in. Loved the safari park. Surprised she didn't bring home a giraffe one day, right, and say, here's a new pet. The fact that she and John went to seminary together, you know, studied theology and then traveled across the United States. And what I typically like to do when I talk about somebody's life and try to bring a little bit of perspective and hope from the Bible is to find one aspect of their life and say, well, let's talk about this one. But your mom has way too many of those, all right? It was really tough. And it got me thinking about really what is in our memorial folder today. If you have that, take it 1 minute. Look at the front cover. Can you look at that face and not smile back? I mean, it just brings warmth. She made life richer. On the inside, we have the schedule, and where it comes down to along beside my name in the order of service, it says words of hope. And I got to thinking about hope. And though we laugh today and we enjoy the memories, at the same time, there's a deep sense of loss. She was a good friend, great mom, a wonderful grandmother. I mean, to see those pictures, just delightful. Hope. Hope is a sense of confidence that something good is going to happen. It's a trust in someone or something that brings peace, even in the middle of chaos. On a day like today, there are a lot of different emotions, from the laughter and the joy to the gratitude. I love the way she named her book, you know, her gratitude deal. That is so her. There's gratitude for her character and her laughter, the things that she did and who she was that brought joy to our lives. there is a deep sense of sorrow, loss. One of you mentioned the relief. The last few weeks of her life were very difficult ones, and you all cared for her wonderfully. You shared her with us. Vicki, I knew you took a lead in that because you lived here. And as a church family, we would say to you, thank you. But a relief that comes. What about the hope? Cheryl sang a song about rest on high, or go to heaven and the angels will hear you sing. Cheyenne read from Psalm 23 that the hope is to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And it makes me stop and think, even in my role, is this delusional religious thinking that there's life beyond this one? Or is it true? Is it really the way things are, that there's more to our existence than just what happens here on earth? I want to tell you there is hope, because death is not the end, and God has a much bigger plan for us. I love the way Paul wrote about it in the book to the Romans. He wrote this letter to him. It's kind of a long letter. But in chapter 5 of his letter, he begins talking about hope. And I want you to think this, first of all. Believing in Jesus brings hope in the face of death. Believing in Jesus brings hope even in the face of death. Paul wrote it this way. He said, since we've been made right with God by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ did for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. There's a confidence about the future and what's coming based on faith in Jesus. Louise was a woman of strong faith and deep character. She once in a while caught my arm on a Sunday morning and shared her passion as well. She was both respectful and respected. She was faithful to what she was committed to, and she was full of faith. But what she wanted more than anything was for her family and friends to understand there's hope. There's a confidence. Remember that definition at the beginning? That something good is going to happen. A trust that brings peace even in the face of death. Secondly, there's hope because believing in Jesus brings hope in life. Hope in Jesus is not just for, well, I'm going to die someday and I better think about it. God has good stuff for us in this life even now. And the richness of relationships and friends is so much evidenced by what we all experienced from Louise. We saw that believing in Jesus brings hope in the face of death. It also brings hope in the process and the day-to-day living. Paul wrote about it this way. He said, we can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he's given us his Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. Believing in Jesus brings great hope in life as well. I don't know what your mom was thinking when John called her from the hospital, and she's a 17-year-old girl. And many of you know the story of how John and Louise met, and John had a really tragic accident early in life. They were not married. And John calls Louise as this little 17-year-old girl and says, I need you to come be with me. So she gets on this train and bus, and she travels to visit this guy who, I mean, she barely knew. And so what does John do in the hospital where, you know, he's so grateful that she has come? He asks her to marry him. Now, I would have loved to have been there when she went home to her parents and said, well, I went to see this guy because he wanted me to help him, and guess what? You know, I got this ring on my finger now. John had some that was a significant, tough time in his life, and Louise came alongside of him and was his encouragement. John and Louise had seasons of challenge even in their own spiritual journey. They'd gone to seminary together. They'd learned about God. Tough things in their life happened. And in that journey, they had to face the reality of what it means to live as a human with all the shortcomings and to be treated in difficult ways at times. Through it all, the difficulties that they faced, Louise was the woman who said, God, I'm going to trust you. And it deepened her character, did it not? We got to see the reflection of her commitment. Believing in Jesus brings hope in the face of death. Believing in Jesus brings hope in life. There are seasons that were not easy for them, but she continued to trust him. The last thing I'd like to say before we leave is that believing in Jesus brings hope in the moment. Paul wrote it this way. He said, when we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. God showed his great love for us by sending Jesus. And now, for since our friendship with God has been restored by Jesus dying for us when we were his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his Son. So now, in this moment, we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because of Jesus making us his friend. And I thought that's kind of a great way to walk out of here today. One is the confident hope that there's life after death for those who trust Jesus as their Savior. But there's also hope in this life that when the difficult things come, God can use those to transform our character to make us more like Jesus. Sometimes I look at those things as, okay, when that happens. But Paul ends that chapter and says, at the right moment, now is the time to put your hope in him, because he has this moment for us to live, to enjoy each other, to enjoy him. Hope brings, or believing in Jesus brings hope in death. It brings hope in life, and it brings hope in the moment. If there was anybody who had an indomitable hope, I love that self-assuredness. I can do this. It was Louise, was it not? Her faith and her trust in Christ. I want to invite you to stand with me, and let's pray together as we close our time. If you came with somebody, I would simply invite you to reach out and grab their hand, and let's connect as families and friends, connected through our friendship and love for Louise. God, thank you for the privilege of hearing wonderful stories. Thank you for the privilege of sharing life with Louise. And I want to say to you, thank you for the hope that we have that death is not the end, because the tomb is empty. There's life after death. Thank you that there's hope even when we face tough times. I think in particular for this family as they miss Louise and the holidays and the birthdays that come, weddings and those significant moments in a family's journey, those difficult moments. God, you give hope and encouragement, a confidence that there's a good thing that you have even when it's tough. And God, I would ask, might you touch every heart here that in this moment it would put hope and trust in you to make the most out of it for your glory. So we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a little bit of a reception coming. Before you all leave, I want to let the family kind of get started leaving first. So if you guys would kind of work your way out. We're headed out to the family center, and one of the reasons I let them leave first is so that they can claim a table and grab a snack and a drink before we all go out there and take all the food from them. So this is a way to get them out there. For those of you who may be new to Emmanuel Faith, there's a tower kind of straight out past where we are in a gymnasium. That's where we're going to be for the reception. It's called the Family Center. As they're walking out, you may have, if I could remind you of one thing here, and I'm supposed to say this and I'm going to do it. If you want to make any donations in her name, they would be to the North County Assistance League or the Women's Resource Center of Escondido, and you can find their info online. Thanks for coming on behalf of this family. Please join us for just a minute or two, if you can, in the family center. God bless.